Hello there, dear Grasshopper users. Hello, computational design community. My name is Benjamin Felbrich. I work at the Institute for Computational Design and Construction at Stuttgart University. And today I want to give you a short introduction into Crow, a plugin for Grasshopper that brings artificial neural networks into the realm of computational design. There are also other frameworks that I want to mention, for example, OWL, which is, I think, developed in Copenhagen. And also, I think Lunchbox has some machine learning functionality now. I just happen to know Crow best, and that's why I want to give you an introduction to that. So first, we're going to go through the terminology of artificial neural networks a little bit, and show why they could be interesting or important. And then we will try to control a parametric model like this one through some sort of sensor input data. And the mapping between this sensor input data and the parametric model will happen through an artificial neural network. So have fun. Okay, just very briefly about the terminology in artificial neural networks. I'm not going to go too much into detail here. If you're really interested, I can recommend this book by Raul Rojas, Neural Networks, A Systematic Introduction, that is really in-depth, or obviously like the Wikipedia article. You would have found that by yourself as well. Just a few quick terms. So artificial neural networks consist of different layers. We have an input layer and one output layer, and we have layers in between that are called hidden layers. Layers consist of neurons or nodes, and each node in the layer is connected to all the nodes in the following layer. What a neural network can be trained to do is to kind of memorize mappings between inputs and outputs through an optimization algorithm called backpropagation. Specificities are not so important now. It just speaks about adjusting weights between nodes. So for example, you have this node connected to this one by synapse. That is performs some arithmetic that is scaled via a weight. And the backpropagation basically adjusts some weights, or all the weights basically, in order to map certain inputs that you show the network to certain outputs that you also show the network. And that way, a network can be made to represent a function that is not explicitly defined in a formula, but it is just trained or matched or shaped by showing it different output and inputs. So basically, you can train it to learn anything that you want it to do. Traditionally, neural networks were used for classification, and also our example is related to classification. The example we're going to talk about later. The data set that you see here is the classical MNIST data set, where you have like for each of these little pictures, you have a certain number of pixels. And these pixels can be flattened into vectors, and as soon as you have a vector for each of these little pictures, you can feed them into your network, and in the end you tell the network what it should recognize, and for example the number 1 or the number 9. But how exactly that works probably will be better understood in the later examples. So let's get into the script then. In the beginning, I want to show you the main sensor input. So I set up a little Firefly script. You probably are familiar with Firefly. You can see that I have the script up here, and the sensors that I have here are an RGB sensor that measures RGB values. You can see the output of that here. This is red, green, and blue values. And I also have a pressure sensor, which when I press the sensor, you can see that the value up here changes. Now this is, I think, 16 bits and 16-bit resolution, so that means it gives me some number between 0 and 1023. The resolution of the RGB sensors, I'm not entirely sure. I think it's something like 18 bits, but it goes up to something like 8000. Now I have some different colorful papers here, and if I hold, for example, the orange one right in front of the RGB sensor, you can see that the values go a little more towards the red spectrum. When I hold a yellow colored paper, it shows different outputs. And I also have some sort of a blue thing that just happens to be my tape holder, sorry. And that should give us some more blue values. Yes, you can see number two is jumping up. I also, of course, something very bright wet red. That should give us red values. Now, we get this data from Firefly. It's, of course, a little bit noisy. That's just the nature of the sensor. And it also gives us very high values. And somehow we need to find a way of turning that sensor data into a meaningful input for our parametric model. That is defined here. The specificities of what it does exactly are not so important right now. I just want to show you that it mainly takes in three inputs, parameter A to C. And when I change, for example, parameter A, you can see that it changes the shape from a concave to a somewhat convex shape. If I change parameter B, that changes the number of legs on which my canopy-like structure stands. And parameter C changes the kind of resolution of this mesh in between. I know it's maybe not the most beautiful design, it's like that's not the main focus of this video. I just also want to point out that some of the values are continuous, like this change of or this interpolation between different states, and some are discrete, so the number of legs is a very discrete value. I also want to point out that all my parameter values range from 0 to 1, and the scaling and application of these values into the parametric model happens afterwards, but the inputs remain in the range from 0 to 1. So to sum up again, we have some sensor input on the left that gives me some fairly high values that are rather noisy and we're not yet sure how they could be meaningful. And we have a parametric model on the right that takes values between 0 and 1 to generate a certain model. Now what we want to do, or what the purpose of this video is we want to relate these this data to one another. So we want a neural network to recognize certain sensor states or certain situations of sensors and generate the appropriate output in this situation. So in that way I can kind of control with my sensors how the output would look like. Now you might say, sure, that's rather simple. You can just write code or write some grasshopper definition that takes these values, processes them somehow, and somehow translates that into input for my parametric model. The problem with that are a few different aspects. First, my data is pretty high and rather noisy, so if the data changes, I would have to go through a lot of effort to damp down the noise in order to get some stable or robust output. Secondly, whenever I want to change my input states, or whenever I want to give it a different definition, I would have to rewrite my code. The power of a neural network is that I can, without explicitly coding or without explicitly defining how it would work, I can make the network perform these transitions or perform this function just by showing it desired input and output states. We call these training samples. A training sample is the relation between an input state and an output state. Imagine it like a function. So I want to define, I want to find some sort of function that maps input data on the x-axis to some sort of output state on the y-axis. Only that my x-axis doesn't consist of one value but four, and my output, the y-axis, consists of three values. So the analogy is a little bit more complicated, but you can imagine it something like this. But the point is that I do not write a very complicated, very big formula that somehow shapes this function. I just show it some certain cornerstones of the function. For example, here, 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 and here, through the neural network. So the neural network is nothing else but the representation of a function that I define through showing it some certain cornerstones in the function. So how do we do that? To remind you, an artificial neural network consists of an input layer with a number of input neurons or nodes, a number of hidden layers, some nodes in each hidden layer, and an output layer also consisting in, for example, of four nodes here. So we somehow have to find bring this structure into Grasshopper. For that, in Crow, you have this component, the CrowNet constructor. There are three different inputs. Let's start with the second one. It asks me when I hover over with the mouse the amount of neurons per layer provided in the layer structure. So in this example, I have two hidden layers. The backpropagation constructor only talks about hidden layers. So forget about input layer and output layer for now. I have two hidden layers. Each of the hidden layers has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 nodes. So in Grasshopper, I would define that as a list of integers. So say 7 and 7. Don't forget to hit the multiple, to untick the multiline data. And I connect that here. So now I told it I have two hidden layers, and each of the hidden layers has 7 nodes. I could also tell it I have two hidden layers, my first one has 5 nodes and my second one has 6 nodes. Now the first input talks about the type of these layers, specifically about the activation function in each node of the layer. The activation function is something you can look up at Wikipedia. I might not go into, or I would not go into the details right now, but it basically is defined in a similar fashion. You give it, since we have two hidden layers, we have to give it two different characteristics for both layers. So I want to have a sigmoid layer 0 and a linear layer 1. So I tell it 0 and 1. Again, untick multiline data and connect. The third input is the learning rate. We're also not going to go into the learning rate now. You can read it up on Wikipedia. But these, for our purpose, this structure should be fine. To sum it up again, we just defined a neural network that has two hidden layers, where the first one has 5 nodes and the second one has 6 nodes. And the first layer is of sigmoid type, of a sigmoid activation function. And the second layer has a linear activation function. So this is all we need to construct a neural network, and we have it here in the net output. Secondly, we take the Crow engine backpropagation component. You can see that it takes a net input. So we connect the net that we just constructed to our engine. It turns red because it's lacking the other inputs. The first input is the number of training cycles per training. 1,000 is good, just for the sake of speed up, I would keep it at 100 for now, but we can increase it later. Now it becomes more interesting. We have the training in and the training output. Both of these are defined as trees. Now training input and training output relate to the input and output layers in the neural network. In the training input layer, I want to show my desired input at a certain state, so that would be the sensor input. And I want to show it the desired output that relates to this input on this side. To sum it up, we have 4 sensor values that are relevant for us. I'm just going to merge them real quickly. So now our sensor state just consists of a list of 4 numbers. Again, to repeat, each training sample, each kind of cornerstone in our function consists of a training input and the respective training output that we want the network to return for that sensor input. So this would be the desired output. So what I could do now already is to give my network the first training sample, or one training sample. So say my list of input values is my training input, and my list of respective output values is my training output. Like so. And you can see that the component is not red anymore. Now, there are a few problems with this. First, one training sample isn't really meaningful. It would basically tell the network, whatever you see, just give me this output. Now, there's another problem with that. Our values here are really high. The network in the background is designed in a way that it works best with values between 0 and 1. So somehow, on the input side, we will have to scale our values or modify them so that they are contained within the domain from 0.0 to 1.0. For example, for the pressure sensor, again, if I press it real hard, it goes up to a max of 1023 because it's a 10-bit sensor. So I can just scale it. If I divide my value that I get by the maximum that it can reach, which is 1024, then I get kind of the percentage of pressure, the percentage of maximum pressure. So you see, now it's almost zero. And if I press it, just to show you again, and if I press it really hard, it should go up to something like one, exactly. And everything in between. Now for the second sensor set, this is not as simple. First, I'm not entirely sure what the maximum redness would be, even if I showed something that is very orange. It goes to something like 12,000. But if I have changing light conditions, everything might be brighter and I might have very high values in general. If it is really dark but still red, I will get very low values. But I still want to detect within that pattern if my color is pretty red or not so red. So what I want to do is I want to pre-process that data in a very meaningful way, or as meaningful as possible. Now Crow has a component that is called Analyze Data. And let me put that in here. So it has a lot of, or it just has a number of different algorithms that it performs on the training vector, or the list of training values that you give it. This is like the arithmetic mean, that's just the average, the geometric mean, minimum value, maximum value, the range of all values, the variance, the standard deviation, the vector length. If you assume this to be a vector instead of a list of values, then you can compute a vector length. You can then scale this vector by this length. You can apply what is called the softmax function. I'm not going to explain what the softmax function is. You can look it up in Wikipedia. Let me just connect an output. So this is now the list that we got in as an input scaled by the highest value, so that the highest value is always 1 and all the others are scaled accordingly. Now if I show it something that is very blue, you will see that the blue values go to 1 and the others are scaled down. So now I contain my data that is rather fuzzy and big, I contain it in a smaller range. And it makes sense to connect these values instead. Here. And here. And there you go. Now we trained the network with one training sample. But keep in mind, the way that you scale down your data is entirely up to the task that your neural network should perform. For example, my color value, I just scaled it down by the highest value because I want to know which one is the highest, for example red, and how high the red value is compared to the others, so I get the intensity of the color. That is important to my task of color detection. But it might be an entirely different strategy that you need to apply for your specific use case. So try to think of a sensible way to scale down your data into the scale of 0 to 1. So to recap what we just did, we constructed the network in a certain structure, two hidden layers, 5 and 6 nodes, and we trained that network with one training sample. Now if we go back to our function, we can say that we showed the function that we want to find one cornerstone. So that is not very meaningful.
basically you test the network, whatever you get, give me the same output. But what we can already do or try to do is to use the classifier. That is the last important component. It's located here, backpropagation vector classifier. So as you can see, it also takes a network input. And here we're going to use our now trained network. And we're going to show it an input vector. That is basically the new input that the network has not yet seen, that is not part of the training input or training output. And it will from that generate the respective training output. So we could say that we use the construct network and the training network to shape this function. So the first two steps are just to define the shape of that function. The last step, classification, uses that function by giving it a new x value and trying to see what it returns. So training the network is shaping the function, using it as a classifier uses this function. So let me go ahead and internalize the training input data here and the training output data. So now our network is fixed. It is trained with only one training sample though, but we'll improve on that later. We pass it to the vector classifier, and here we can now use that trained network, and I'm going to do that by just giving it new, like previously unseen sensor data that comes directly from Firefly. Let's see what it returns. There's actually something. We can connect that directly to our parametric model by using the item components and passing these values into the parameters that define our parametric model. So on this stage, actually the network now generates the parametric model based on the sensor input. The problem, as I mentioned before, is that it doesn't really know a lot because it only saw one training sample so far. So if we show it something else, let's see what happens. Well, not much really. If I show it a different color, and maybe I press my sensor, not much happens either. So the point is, in order to shape our function further, we need to supply more cornerstones, more training samples, more different situations. So I just removed the classification component here, and I'm going to use the manual input again to generate the parametric model. Something like this. These wires are invisible, but they are connected. So now what I want to do, I want to show my network different states of sensors and tell it to relate them to different outputs. So I want to do that, or I need to do that, in a tree structure. When you look in the training in, when you hover your mouse over the training input in the backpropagation training engine, you can see that it asks for numbers in a tree, and also numbers in a tree. So to visualize that a little bit better, here you see the training input tree and the training output tree structure. The training input tree, each branch relates to one training sample. So sample 0, training branch 0, in the training input and training output tree. Sample 1 is a branch 1, and so on. Now, the training sensor tree, obviously each branch has 4 values, because we have 4 sensor values, these 4. And in training output, we obviously have 3 values in each tree branch, because 3 values control our model. So this is how the structure, how our training trees should look like. So, and I'm going to record what I'm doing with the data recorder. Now, if I connect these values, and let me connect this panel here, it will give me, it will record a continuous stream of values, which is not very nice. It also has nulls in there, which is also not very nice. So first we're going to graph the tree. In an effort to actually record a data tree, we have to graph the values, and after we record it, we have to flip the matrix. That we do that by flip with a flip matrix command. So now when I hit this button a few times, you can see that it records a number of values. Now what happened to the nulls? Are they still in there? Nope, they're gone. That's great. Oh no, they're there. That is not great. Okay, then I have to clean. Use the clean tree. There you go. So now you have a nice clean now you have a nice clean tree structure that looks like this. Since I hit the button three times and I recorded three training samples, all of which had the same values though, but each of them generated one tree branch that was just attached with the data recorder, and now my tree branch has my training input tree has three branches, each of which has four values. I'm going to do the same for the training output. Just let me do that quickly. And you know what, I'm not actually going to record this training sample only once. That is, this sensor input data and this training output data, I'm going to record it not only once, like here, sample one, but since I have a timer attached to Firefly anyways, I can record a lot of these values. So I attach the timer to Firefly, that triggers a new sensor output, so a data update in my sensor input data. Or training input data, sorry. And I also connect it to the training output data. So whenever I get new sensor data, I also record the same or the respective training output data. I will record that in my trees, and let's see what we end up with. So I'm going to show it the green pen. And I will also press the button in a second. Something like this. You see the values, they should go into the green realm. Yes. Something like this. That's actually enough. Now first let me stop recording so we can make changes for the next training sample. Let's see what we have. We just recorded 96 tree branches of sensor input data. That is more or less the same. It is all kind of green and all high pressure. And also we recorded 96 tree branches of this training output data. That's okay. So let's set up the next training sample. So that should be, I want to show it an orange piece of paper. And that I want the network to associate with, say, a model that looks like this. It's a little more concave. It only has, three legs, why not? And a very low resolution or density of this mesh. Okay. So now when I hit record, it will record the updated training output data, and it will also, since I showed the orange piece of paper now, it will also record the new training input data. So I'll hit record and the timer, and as you can see, the color will diverge a little bit. Yeah, more into the red realm. You can see that the values vary a lot, but since I scaled them, it's okay. So the relation is more or less the same. That's enough. Turn off the recording and see what we got. Okay, we have two trees of 260 branches each. Yep, and they should match. Okay, let's go to the next model then. I want to tell the network whenever it sees a whenever it sees a blue input, something like this, a blue input, and mediocre pressure, I want it to give me a very high resolution, a high lag count, something like this, and maybe 0.5 in concaveness, let's say. Okay, so I will associate, I will tell the network to associate this shape with a blue input. Let's hit record. That should be enough. Let's check if our branches, trees still match. Yes, 409 branches and 409 branches. Perfect. So now we have three training samples and we all recorded them multiple times. We had orange, red and blue. We had orange, green and blue. Now let's go for red. And I would say red with also mediocre pressure. This is the red. And we want the network to associate that with, say, 0.2. I'm not sure if we already had that. The highest lag count. And something like 0.3. Yeah. I always check if the trees still match. Let's do one more and then we're good. So I have another yellow piece of paper here. And I want to have yellow with a very high pressure again. And the model that it should give me looks something like this. Three legs, very high resolution and very concave. Yes, that totally looks like a yellow high pressure model. Okay. Stop the recording. So now we have two perfectly matching trees. They represent five training samples, but each training sample is recorded a lot of times, which is good. So now I can go ahead and feed this information into my network to train it. We still have, I think, 100 training cycles, so it should be fairly fast. There you go. So now we trained our network with, almost 700 samples. Now, sometimes, especially when you go into higher training sample counts, I would say maybe 2000 for now, you don't want to retrain your network, especially when you have a lot of training data, and you don't want to always retrain your network whenever you reopen your grasshopper definition. So that's why you can save your network when you go right click onto the component and say save network, and I just save it somewhere in my documents as network. No, let's say ColorNet. You can now use this network here, or also open up another instance, I think, no, sorry, and load the same file that we just saved down here, colornet.h. dort zu sehen wie calnet.crow network. And you have the same trained network output. To recap what we just did, we shaped this function again. But this time we had a lot of values and it might have a better shape this time. Let's see how it works. The function is existing, now we're going to use this function for classification. Let me delete this one. We just use the one where we loaded the old network. So we again use a vector classifier, put in the loaded crownet, and now we can connect again new sensor data that the network hasn't seen before and see what it returns. So I connect new sensor data in here. It has to have the same length four values as my training input, as these ones. Here each tree branch also has four values, of course. And it should return three values, exactly. And I can connect those now with the item components to actually control my parametric model. One, two, three. Sorry. Come on. Okay. So now at this stage we have a trained neural network that we trained on sensor input data and the respective desired output data. And from this trained network, we now ask it to give us some insights. So let's see now. We're actually done. Now I want to see what happens if I hold, say, the yellow one here again. Oh, sorry, I should turn on mine. Okay. So now this is basically like the default. And since the values jitter a lot, it's not so nice. But what happens if I hold the yellow? Yeah. Now, I actually, to be honest, I didn't keep in mind how the network or what exactly which training data I gave it. Maybe you can go back in the video and check. But what if I give it some red? Oh, that looks like a totally red neural network. Now let's show it some blue. I'm not sure if I gave it pressure before. There you go. Now we go for green again and high pressure. That was the very first training sample. And that looks pretty much like a green value. Now we can also start playing and see what happens if we have something in between, say a turquoise colored input. Maybe it interpolates somehow. And the last one, orange. There we go. It looks like the red one a little bit. Yeah, sure, because orange and red look almost the same. Okay. Now, while I play around with this one a little bit, I want to mention some other things. Say here, green. Maybe you can go back in the video and compare if that actually matches what it should output. I'm not entirely sure. I haven't checked it yet. Sorry, I just turned off the rendered preview because it was a little bit slow. One thing that I wanted to talk about is the second output that the training network gives. That is MSE, or mean squared error. That basically gives you a measure about how well your network is trained. And the lower the value is, the better. Now here, since I just loaded my network from the hard drive, I don't get the MSE. But usually you should have something under 0.01. If it's larger than 0.01, then that's actually not so good, and you should consider to increase the number of training cycles or try to get better data. Speaking of data, the more data you get, or the more data you can collect, the better it is. It's actually like a, it's like a rule of thumb in the kind of artificial intelligence community that more data is always better than a better algorithm. So if you can collect more data, as I just did with this timer, then you should do that. The other thing is, this collecting more data only makes sense if your data varies a little bit. Like in this example, the sensor data is actually pretty noisy, and that is good because it gives it trains the network in a more robust way. If all your sensor, if all your values are the same, or if all training samples are exactly the same, then you will run into a problem that is called overfitting, where actually your network is trained only to precisely recognize exactly your training samples but nothing else. And if you then diverge a little bit in your later classification, that might lead to unpleasant results. So noise is actually not so good, obviously only within a certain range, and trying is always, always a good idea. Another word on the actual network structure that we define here. How exactly a neural network should be defined is not trivial. It's actually a very complicated question, and there are like books and PhDs written about that topic. I can just say, for example, for a value with around 4 sensor input data, then it makes sense to use maybe 2 layers, where each layer has a little more nodes than your input data or your output data. It consider that if you have a layer of only 1 value, if you go back to this one, if you had happen to have a layer with only 1 node, that would mean that somewhere in your entire classification algorithm, all the information has to be broken down into 1 value and then reinterpreted from there again. So try to avoid bottlenecks where you only have 1 or 2, unless it really makes sense. But this is fine. Also, usually having a little more nodes than necessary is not too bad. That might just increase your computation time. And last but not least, and actually very important, is your network is only going to perform as well as you handle the data. So if I plugged in this raw data, or I just scaled the data in a way that is not sensible, then I will get output that is not sensible as well. So it's really important that you think about how you scale your data, how you use your data. Maybe you can even consider using the softmax function or the normalized softmax function, something like this, or try it out a little bit. I guess it's also about getting a little feeling of what could work and what could not work. So that was it for this tutorial. While the network is just kind of running on idle and dreaming by itself, see what it returns if I show it the finger. Oh, that's actually not too bad. See what it shows if I show it my phone. Something like this. thanks a lot for the attention. My name is Benjamin Felbrich from the ICD in Stuttgart University, and that was Crow. You can find Crow on my GitHub. That is here. I just wrote the link, github.com/heinzbenjamin/crow. And yeah, if you like, give me some feedback. Maybe if you do something with a neural network, I would be really interested in seeing what you do with it, what data you use, how you kind of pre-process your data, and I'm happy about any comments. See you later.